So the purpose of today's lecture is to really look at a very long timeline of the history of protest and political reform within Perth. We're covering about 700 years today. So we're not going to go into a huge amount of detail, but I just want to focus on some of the main themes and stories that emerged from those themes over the course of that timeline. But I'd like to start with a quote from that famous author, Lewis Grassett Gibbon. He wrote in Sunset Song 1932, "With them we may say there died a thing older than themselves. These were the last of the peasants, the last of the old Scots folk. A new generation comes up that will know them not except as a memory in a song." So this demonstrates the continuum of history. Obviously, we've got a lot of protests taking place at the moment. There is still the cause and the fight for social justice, for voters' rights and equality. But it's important to link the current generation with the understanding of the past so we know where we've come from to inspire the future. So what are we going to explore today? Well, first of all, we're going to look at the early formation of what was known as guilds and incorporations within Perth. These groups of merchants and tradespeople who came together to have their voices heard. In parallel to that, we're going to look at the growth of political radicalism within Perth, mainly focused in the 18th century. We're then going to look at the evolution towards the concept of what's known as Victorian paternalism and how that differs from philanthropy. And then finally, we're going to look at the big chapter of Scottish history, which is suffrage and votes for women. So the story really begins with this charter. This is a 14th century copy of a charter that dates from 1210. Written in Latin, it confirms Perth's status as a royal borough. So with royal boroughs, the establishment of royal boroughs, it essentially enabled tradesmen, people with power, people with land, to have a say in local politics and at a national level. It also established local trading rules and regulations, including who was allowed to trade, who was not allowed to trade, whether or not foreigners could come in and trade within a borough, tax requirements as well. So what did this charter establish? Well, the charter established what was known as guilds. The early guilds essentially were the merchants of Perth. There were people with control, land, business and property. They were representatives of people who worked for them. They didn't necessarily represent the wishes and the interests of workers, but they were the business owners. From its members, they enabled the election of the local councils, and this included the baileys, the provost and the dean of guild, who constituted the borough council. The charter also established, this 1210 charter, prevented people from making any dye cloth that was not a burgess within the town's merchant guild. So a burgess was somebody who had license to produce cloth and other items. And in this early period, the guild was the body which protected the financial interests of the merchant. So again, it's focusing on the merchant, it's not focusing on the workers. But obviously this was, although it was a step in the right direction, it wasn't enabling people who worked for the merchants, or indeed, you know, the weavers or the shoemakers, etc. It didn't really give them many rights. And this charter, from James I in 1424, brought in a new tier of collective interest set up to a guildry which then maintained standards. So we have the guildry, Perth's guildry, which represents all of the merchants within Perth, but we don't have the individual interests of industries represented in any democratic fashion. This charter enabled the crafts within Perth and Perthshire to be set up in what was known as incorporations, which each had their own deacon, which made sure that the taxes were paid. But crucially, this charter brought together a culmination of the royal boroughs, which enabled the creation of mercats, represented by their mercat crosses, one of which is in Crieff, And it created designated calendar days for markets where traders could come to exchange goods with people. The current Perth Guildry has this item in their collection, which is known as the Locket Book. Now, this is dating from 1452, so it's after the Perth Guild was formally established. But this book is incredibly important because it contains a list of all of the early incorporations and the merchants that existed in Perth from the mid-15th century onwards. It's called the Locket Book, as you may guess, because it kept its contents secure. You couldn't just write any business name in there or any incorporation or any interest. It had to be specifically approved by the guild. So why were incorporations actually established? We've got the guild, we've got representation of the merchants. But as we were discussing there, there was too much power vested by them. The merchants could elect members into the borough council, people who worked within incorporations or worked within the specific trades didn't have a say in local politics. So there was a lack of representation of craftsmen and their interests compared to merchants. And it's this conflict, this struggle that we see developing throughout the forthcoming decades and centuries. The burgesses still existed, the people with licenses still existed, and they were usually granted a burgess whether or not they had land, they had property, or they were born into a specific family. The incorporations were formalised by a 1469 Act, but this really came into conflict with the principle of incorporations, because guild members could still elect its own successors. So despite the fact that we have these incorporations starting to be formed within Perth, the 1469 took us a step backwards, because the council could by leet, i.e. identify people in advance who they wanted to be on council, could still determine the outcome of elections. So essentially the guild could elect its own successors, therefore the council could elect its own leadership. So what advantages did membership bring for incorporations? Well, it established apprenticeships, which we all know today of being, of gross importance, mass importance to people who are developing their careers. It enabled the workers to have their voices heard, raise concerns, and to set up collective ventures. So if you had a business idea or if you had specific business interests, you could discuss within a forum and look at collaborating. It also enabled the steady reduction of taxes and fees. So obviously if you're in an incorporation and you feel that your business has not been treated well, or as a collective of businesses that have not been treated well, then you've created a pressure group. So the incorporation therefore becomes a pressure group towards the guild. So the 1424 Act actually acted as a springboard to the formation of incorporations within Perth. There were eight of these that were formed, the most prominent and perhaps the earliest being the Weavers Incorporation of Perth. The others included the bakers, the fleshers, the glovers, the hammermen, the shoemakers, the tailors, the weavers, and the wrights. Now, the Weavers Incorporation of Perth is an interesting one because we don't know exactly when it was set up, but what we do know is that it has deep roots in history, mainly because Flemish weavers had been in Perth from the 12th century onwards, and we know that the craft and the exports from that craft towards Europe and beyond were well established. After the Napoleonic Wars, these kind of foreign links, these trading networks were obviously damaged. So those links with the Flemish people, Germany, France, etc., were broken. This resulted in prices plummeting, wages falling, and obviously the decrease in living standards. This also, obviously, as a result, came into conflict with the increase of trade locally. So despite the fact that we've got damaged markets abroad, we've got a growth in the domestic market, and then that ties us in to the increase in mechanization and the Industrial Revolution. But crucially, the weavers and corporation had set up apprentices and journeymen. So if you wanted to gain a trade, start off in an industry, then you could apply to become an apprentice. This photograph here of Carr's Croft is actually a house as an apprentice that you would have stayed in. So you wouldn't have just gone to work in a factory, you would have stayed with a family, an established weaver, and you would have lived with them. Now there were several routes into becoming an apprentice, and we're going to talk about that. You could either buy yourself into it, or you could apply, or you had right because of your family. The freemen were the people within an corporation who had the right to vote on matters and political party matters. Obviously, with the right to vote, then you could put pressure on the guildry and you could establish change within the local area. But how could you become a freeman? Well, you could marry into it, was one, and that would cost you 40 merks. You could complete an apprenticeship, which would cost you 100 merks. You could have hereditary rights, which was 20 merks, which is kind of ironic because obviously that's the lowest fee there, or you could buy yourself into it, which was £100 Scots. So you can see this huge economic disparity emerging with regards to membership into the incorporations and therefore the right to vote. Now, apprenticeships, as we know, took place all the way from the 15th century through to the present day. And there we have some coopers of Dewars who had just, the chap of which in the middle was a journeyman. And a journeyman's role was obviously to train up apprentices. And the chap to the left of him there, who's William Anson, had just finished his apprenticeship of 8 years. So the second apprenticeship that I want to talk about is called the Tailor and Corporation of Perth. This is the tailor's plaque that we have in the museum, and that's our catalogue record. It was set up in about 1525, and it actually included two crafts, the tailors and the stay makers, who were corset makers. In the earliest times, the tailors would travel to the clients to make and mend their garments, so they didn't have their own shops within Perth. Unlike, for example, when we get through to the Pullers story where we have these large factories and we have shops that are set up, these are craftspeople that actually travelled to your home and mended your garments. The incorporation really reached its peak in the 1700s until there was a huge amount of debt that was run up due to embezzlement by what was known as the boxmasters, who were basically the financial controllers of the day, Alexander Paul and William Paul. The incorporation was then put into receivership in the early 19th century, 1808, and then later declared bankrupt. So it's a very early incorporation, but obviously had financial struggles right from the get-go. The Shoemaker Incorporation of Perth, we don't know when it was set up, but we think it was the early 18th century. They had a shoe market in South Street on Fridays. The leather was made by the Skinner craft and was also widely used across other trades, including glove making and saddlery. They had a strict monopoly enforced to protect the work of the individual crafts. Those are some of the items that we've got in the collection with regards to shoemaking. We've obviously got the banner here, and we've got the minute book dating from 1793 as well. Perhaps our most famous incorporation is the glovers, because we have quite a large amount of material in the collection that relates to the glovers. So as you may know, that is a portrait of St. Bartholomew. It is dated 1557, as you can see in the bottom of the panel there. Although I think it might have been retouched by another artist a couple of hundred years later on. But it was established from the late 15th century. It comprised, again, of not just one craft, but two crafts, the glovers and the skinners, who produced the leather. And you may, you know, question as to why we've got a knife here, and we've got the scissors, and we've got the gloves. Well, the gloves are obvious, the scissors are obvious. The knife might not be so obvious, which I'll talk to you about in a second. But essentially, the glovers became extremely large. Its membership grew considerably, mainly because it attracted investment from some of the most wealthy people in Perth, who had land They also established the Glover's Hole, which was in Northport about 1620. It's just around the corner now. It's now known as the Fair Maid of Perth's House. They also had peculiar little customs as well, including the Glover's sword dance. We've got a costume dating from the period that's undergoing some restoration at the moment, and we have their shoes as well. So they were quite an unusual, kind of a little bit kitsch kind of organisation with its own customs. But this portrait is a crucial indication of the Scottish Reformation as well, because during the Scottish Reformation, after John Knox's sermon at St. John's Kirk, it was ransacked. So the entire contents of the Kirk were either destroyed or taken away, but this portrait actually survived. And we don't know exactly why, but obviously it may be a member of the Glover's Incorporation that rescued it. The Baker Incorporation of Perth was established in the late 17th century in 1652. We've actually got a lot of records relating to the Baker's Incorporation through the minute books. But they, like the Glovers, had some peculiar customs and cultural activities attached to them. In particular, they had this annual event, annual play called St. Olbert's Play, which involved people prancing around in disguised dresses, going through the city piping and dancing, striking drums, carrying in their hands and burning torches. So again, it's this idea of incorporations not just being about financial institutions or fora, it's actually about becoming intrinsically part of Perth's local cultural identity as well. The Flesher Incorporation was not related to the Glovers, but they were related to, obviously, butchers. We have records from them that date from about the 17th century onwards, 1603. You may know where Flesher's Market was, but this is obviously Flesher's Venal, which had a bit of artistic interpretation a few years ago. So they were mainly based next to, well, in front of St. John's Kirk, where they would hold market. So you would go down there every weekend for your meat and vegetables. But it was also quite gruesome as well. So within this venal, it would have been quite common to see animals being slaughtered there or being hung up to drip dry, basically. So quite a gruesome sight. But obviously, again, part of Perth's cultural identity at that point. The rights of incorporation of Perth, little of it remains in terms of the architectural heritage, but if you head down this street here, which is in the Watergate, you may see this little unassuming door. So despite the fact that it is a listed building, you will be able to see the Wright's coat of arms just above the door there. I'm not entirely sure what the building's been used for at the moment, but it looks fairly ill cared for. The Wright's incorporation consisted of Wrights who, you know, were woodworkers. They would be mending carts and other transport material. But they also represented several other crafts, including barbers, which is a bit unusual, coopers, slaters, plasterers, glaziers, and masons. So this was a huge incorporation representing a wide range of interests. As I was saying, their hall was based here in Watergate, which was built in 1725, and you can still see their crest above the doorway. The Hammerman Incorporation of Perth was a lot earlier. They began in the 16th century. These are your blacksmiths, and these are your coopers, but they also included your gunsmiths, your jewelers, your goldsmiths, your silversmiths, your brass and iron founders, your pewter workers, your tinsmiths, and plumbers. So again, a massive umbrella organization and corporation representing all of the interests of these trades. The incorporation actually continued all the way through until fairly recently, until 2008. Their motto was, "By hammer in hand, do all art stand." The Hammerman Hall was based in the High Street. But you can see there is what we call a boxmaster, who was basically, as I was saying, the financial controller or the treasurer of the organisation, who became quite famous. Mainly because he had interests abroad. He set up a number of trading vessels. that went out to the South and North America. So he was involved in kind of like transatlantic trade as well. So just to summarize where we're at the moment, we've got right at the top of the power triangle, the merchant guilds who represented the interest of the trading corporations, but the burgesses had been pushed down the triangle. So right at the start of the establishment of the royal boroughs, the burgesses were right at the top. So there is this ongoing power struggle between the burgesses, the merchant guilds, and the trading corporations. It should be said that obviously the trading corporations and the merchant guilds were closely linked. So you would have had people that were involved in both. But obviously, to be a member of the guild, you had to be an owner of property, you had to be an owner of a company. And that's where the trading corporations, the members, were unable to have a say. So this is all happening in parallel to a general feel that people aren't getting equal rights, people aren't having the chance to participate in local democracy, they certainly don't have the vote. And these ideals are kind of fueled by the British defeat in the American War of Independence in 1783. The franchise at that point in Perth was so restricted that in the 1788 election, Perthshire only has 161 county voters out of a national total of 2,662. So despite it being such a large area, Perth's representation at national government was actually pretty poor. The borough MPs were elected by delegates from central councils, so Perth had 26 members, so let's put that in perspective. We have the guilds that can elect the local councils, then put forward the borough MPs. This was called by historians this idea of the beautiful order. Basically, if you don't want to rock the boat, the status quo is going to be absolutely fine because the national government is determined by the MPs who are put forward by the local government, and the local government is put forward by the interests of business people, businessmen in particular. But this isn't going to wash, because obviously we're getting these stories from across the world. We've got an increase of transport and communications. It's a lot more easier to be inspired by what's happening in America, and obviously with the French Revolution as well, which we're going to touch on. But essentially, this culminated in Perth with a 1788 petition. This was inspired, really, by a couple of things that were happening at a national level. The Zeno letters, in particular, were written by an author called Thomas McGugger. And these Zeno letters called for parliamentary representation and a complete revisal of that process. Zeno was a Greek god that kind of represented political interests within ancient Greece. This was spurred on by obviously the national movement, which was happening for borough reform. And the 1788 petition was signed by 379 Perthshire inhabitants, many of whom would become leaders of what was known as the Friends of the People. And we'll just kind of discuss that in a bit. So was the petition successful? No, it wasn't. It was dismissed, completely dismissed by the local council. The council kind of, in a very condescending tone, described the petition in these terms. The 3/4 of men of the people that signed the petition are so low in status to the point of station that it would be much against the credit of the town. Why would we want to give representation to these people? They're not going to help us develop. They don't represent our interests. They also highlight the fact that a considerable amount of weavers subscribe. They have no political existence in the council. Isn't that ironic that the weavers are being targeted? If you look in history, you'll find that weavers are actually a highly educated, highly mobile, highly cultured class of people. So obviously, it's in the best interest of the guilds and of the politicians to suppress them as much as we can. But they were really pointing to this fact that they felt that, oh, this petition hasn't been signed by people who are taxpayers. There's no major merchants within this petition. But not so. The contributors within the petition were actually already part of the establishment. 40% of them were what are known as stent payers, which i.e. basically paying tax, That included these individuals: David Livingston, a linen and cotton manufacturer; George Mellis, a merchant who had employed hundreds of workers; and another merchant, John Richardson. So the petition actually contained the names of merchants and not just craftspeople. It also contained, actually, two councillors that had already been elected by the guildry, including John Dow, deacon for the Glovers, and two others. And there's the Glovers beginning to exert their political muscle. But the Dean of Guild, funnily enough, were also getting a bit fed up. They also wanted democracy. They were realising that, inspired again by the American Wars of Independence, that perhaps they should have some reform. They should have more chance to directly elect council members. As I was saying, back then, the councils were still elected by leet. That means that the council determined the role of people who could be put forward for election. If those people were not in a guild, low chance of that, but if they were not by principle part of the guild, then those people would not be put forward by election. So in September 1790, there was another petition that went forward that called for this reform and to enable greater participation in local politics. So that's what's happening on a local level, but in a national, international level, we have these two big events: the American War of Independence, but also the French Revolution. Now, obviously, the French Revolution, beginning in 1789 to 1799, the 10-year war was obviously having huge amounts of effect within European countries and beyond. Now, Edmund Burke, to the left there, was what we would call these days a bit of a right winger. He believed that in order for society to progress, that people should participate directly within power structures and support those power structures from within. So he didn't believe that dismantling existing power structures were the way forward. He felt that working within the system was the best way for progress. That might be a bit of a gross simplification of what he was saying, but it certainly gives you a bit of a taste of it. In response to that, Thomas Paine pens his famous edict, which is The Rights of Man, which you may have read before. This was written in 1791. Now, Paine took a different approach because he believed that basically that society, humans, people were actually under influence, under the directorship of natural forces, of human nature. But he also believed that government was the direct reason why people had challenges within their lives and communities. So he believed in order to resolve issues at a local level that you did actually have to drastically reform the power structures. He also was firmly against what was known as hereditary government. And we have obviously, we still continue with these debates today. But he believed that people who were born into government by land or title shouldn't exist, basically. And that royal charters should be established with the implication that they could actually be withdrawn. So royal charters themselves, you have a king, you have a queen, releases a royal charter, you can't challenge it. It's the absolute will of the royal family. So the rights of man actually fuels the Perth movement itself. We have this lovely letter from July 1792 from Walter Miller, a cabinet maker, to John Horne Tooke. He talks about how he's printing them, he's distributing them, he's spreading them locally, he's intending to spread them out as far as he can. And it obviously has an effect because on a national level, places like in Edinburgh and Aberdeen and Dundee, they're doing the same thing and they're starting to form this new association called the Friends of the People, which was then formed in Edinburgh. That was the start of the creation of the Friends of the People in Perth, which we'll come on to in a second as well. But it wasn't just the political, it wasn't just the moral, it wasn't just the basis for reform. There was obviously an economic case as well. We've got the Wars of Independence, we've got the French Revolution, we've got changes to industry that are happening, we've got trade ties being made and broken. But essentially, this is really the start of the Industrial Revolution. So we've got this political ferment that's kind of like encouraged by the Industrial Revolution. Essentially, this results in, very simplified terms, population growth, which results in an increase in trade, which then you would hope results in an increase in wages. But that wasn't necessarily the case. And the reason for that is because despite there being an increase in trade, people were going towards the factories. They were no longer artisans. So therefore, the wages, despite increasing, could also decrease as well, according to the supply and demand of the factory. So people were not able to set their own salary or their wages. Now, the old statistical account tells us that despite the fact that we've got a huge wealth of merchants and an increase in wages, to the operative people, the poor were, inverted commas, very numerous. So this is the first time that we realise that the gap between the rich and the poor starts to broaden drastically, despite the fact that we've got an increase in industry within the local area. Now, I'm sure you all recognise this building. This is Stanley Mills. Stanley Mills, built in 1785, was groundbreaking internationally because it was the first mill to use a whole new range of innovative technology. The mills itself represent the kind of the pinnacle, or the start, sorry, of the Industrial Revolution. But essentially, in 1751, there was an act that allowed weavers to work in all parts of Scotland free of corporation dues. So we have the creation of factories like this 30 years previously. We start to see a bit of a relaxation in terms of where weavers could work. So we have weavers, people who are trained as weavers, their families, moving from the rural areas into more urbanised centres. So is this a healthy transition? Well, let's look at this. In the 1770s, we've got 300 weaving looms that have been identified in Perth. By 1810, we've got 3,000 weavers. So this represents, obviously, a rapid expansion of industry. As I was saying, the consequence of that, with the development of what would have been your traditional loom in your farmstead to something that's been mechanised, quite considerable over the course of about 50 years to 100 years, resulted in lower wages and, as a consequence of that, lower standards of living. This is kind of framed what's happening in the rural areas as well. As you may know, before the birth of the toons, before the birth of the villages, we all lived in what was called townships in Scotland. Now, Piers Dixon of the Royal Commission once told, and was told me, and he's written in a few publications, that at one point Scotland actually had 4,000 townships. 4,000 townships, an incredible number. It's hard to imagine that because we don't have 4,000 necessarily towns and villages these days, but we all came from places like this if you were born in Scotland, if you have family in Scotland. Now, the key thing is about the township is that unlike the urban equivalents or even the villages, prior to the development of central farms and agricultural improvement, people lived together pretty much in harmony. They had land in common, which was then divided into crofts. They had a rotation of that land, which was known as the runrig system. They were able to vote for the land that they wanted by drawing stocks. And they essentially had the ability to move across the townships according to where the family was based as well. So this is before we have the concept, you know, the concept of large landowners or single tenant farms dictating the direction, the living standards, the wages of its population. It's also bearing in mind, it's also worth bearing in mind, at this point we had what was called communal townships as well. Now, communal township was essentially where people shared tenancies. So you had an agreed tenancy for your croft, which was then part of a collective of tenancies that operated within a single township. So you weren't necessarily answerable to the owner of the township, but you may have been answerable to a duke or a sheriff who controlled the land. So obviously we've got the Industrial Revolution happening, taking us wee bit back again. And we've got the Society of the Friends of the People forming in Edinburgh. This is the first declaration of the Friends of the People within Perth, that life, liberty and property are equally dear to all who contribute the support of the government. So this basically tells us that it's not just about supporting the government, it's about focusing on our life and our liberty and what we hold true to ourselves. The middle class leadership of the Friends of the People had a specific objective for parliamentary reform. So the Friends of the People was being established by the newly emerging middle classes and the merchants. It still wasn't necessarily representative of the wishes of merchantmen, but it was certainly a step in the right direction. The Friends of the People, not only in Edinburgh, but in Dundee and Aberdeen, Glasgow and in Perth, were getting a wee bit miffed. They became a wee bit more militant. And in 1793, we have a Walter Miller, a cabinet maker, saying that a subscription should be opened up for raising money to purchase arms with the view of enforcing their just demands. So there is this chance that there could be a bit of a revolution that could be taking place. We're making this transition between petitions and peaceful protest to something that could become a wee bit bloody. This culminated in Edinburgh, with the Pike Plot of 1794. Now, 1794, this chap here, David Downey, he was basically the instigator of what could have become quite a bloody scenario within Edinburgh. David Downey and Robert Watt, who were both leaders of the Friends of the People in Edinburgh, essentially went to the black market. They ordered over 4,000 guns, pikes and spears, and then they get busted with 47 of them. So they got caught out very early on. They were very lucky, but not so lucky, as I was saying, is this Walter Miller character, because he was also arrested. So he was still based in Perth, and David Downey was based in Edinburgh, but he was implicated in the raising of arms. Now, obviously, David Downey was sent to the gallows for this attempt at revolution. He was going to be marching on to the castle. He got caught, he got busted, he got sent to the guillotine, hung, drawn and quartered, quite gruesome. Walter Miller was a wee bit lucky. He just got 7 months in jail. He was busted for 7 months, but he was actually never formally charged either. So he's put in jail and then released after 7 months. The second more violent act was known as the Dundas Riots. Now, these were in response to the birthday of George III in 1792. These were also as a result of the introduction of what was known as the Corn Laws in 1791, which established new tariffs and trade restrictions on imported food and corn. Now, Robert Dundas was the Lord Justice Clerk at that point. Essentially, a number of the people within the Friendly Society went on a march and burnt an effigy outside his house, which is seen here in 57 George Square in Edinburgh. But there was inspiration for this event taking place in Perth as well. So there were effigies burnt in Scone, Crieff and Perth. So obviously the news of these riots got back to Perth, and there was a general uprising here as well. Now, Robert Dundas is not to be confused with Henry Dundas, who was his uncle. Now, obviously, Henry Dundas was, again, a major merchantman and politician within the Scottish national scene. But Dundas's effigy was also burnt in Perth, but for different reasons. It wasn't about trade. Now, we all know this story, I hope, but it's about Joseph Knight and Weaverburn, so the freed slave, Joseph Knight. So Dundas, in contemporary history, doesn't look too well because he was actually one of the people who delayed the first slavery abolition bill. He slowed it down. Which resulted in an additional 630,000 African slaves being killed. Effigies of him were also burnt throughout Perth. So This is where the Friends, the Association of the Friends, are starting to get involved in politics, not just about trade, but with interest towards equality and human rights as well. The final bit of story that I want to talk about in terms of developing the franchise is what is kind of a bit of a failed movement within Perth and within Scotland, which is known as Chartism. But the Chartist movement did have some success within Perth. It was separate to the Friends Association, but they were involved obviously in developing charters which demanded equal voting rights for men with property. We have a few events that took place, including bands and processions led by local weavers again. We have a number of meetings joined up with the Friends of the Liberty of Perth that was attended by about 400 people. And we have a political lecturer as well. So obviously we have these trading corporations that are starting to think about the interests not only of the merchants, but of the craftsmen, the craftspeople as well. Then we have the emergence of the Industrial Revolution, where we have these large factories, these looms, Stanley Mills, workers' cottages, workers' housing being produced. The kind of the pinnacle phase of this was known as Victorian paternalism. And I just want to have a wee discussion about this, because this is a concept that seems to permeate all of Perth's major industries, including pullers, jurors, and as you can see there, general accidents. So this takes us forward until the last stages of the 19th century. Now, paternalism within jurors is somewhat complicated. This chap here, Willie Stoddart, was one of the final generation of croopers at jurors, but obviously the preservation of that trade and craft was maintained by the organisation all the way through up until about the late 1960s. But jurors was a company that really established a whole range of benefits to their staff. Quite early on, they arranged staff outings, and they provided pension schemes. They didn't provide sick leave at that point, but they had what was known as a dowry, which meant that as a woman, if you got married, then you were paid off by the organisation, so there was a bit of a sweetener. Unfortunately, you couldn't come back after you got married, but at least it was a step in some kind of direction. But Durer himself actually was quite influential locally. So he became a Liberal councillor in 1843. He then enters the Perth Guild in 1856, becomes a dean in 1862, and then later joins the police commission. Then, as a culmination of his political career, becomes MP for Invernessshire later on as well. But when we look at the fairly modern history of jurors, we know that the equality within the workplace, this idea of establishing roles and cultural activity and identity for its workforce, was determined by the top down. So we have the women of the bottling hall in jurors in the 1960s, and the stories that are emerging from the oral history projects tell us that the men worked as the coopers and the women worked in the bottling hall, and that was determined by the management, it was determined by the board of directors. So how does that relate to Victorian paternalism? Well, it comes back to this ideology where the company believes that they know best for the members of staff, right? So it's saying that we will provide you with specific cultural activities that relate to your own best interests. We will provide you with housing. We will provide you with treatment and care. We will develop your working environment. And the working environment, to an extent, was shown through the development of separate departments for men and women. But one of the other things that come out from not only the jurist story, but for the general accident, is it's the provision of separate facilities. So we have things like separate canteens, we have things like separate sports clubs, men and women are kept apart, and this is something that we see all the way through pretty much to the present day. But Jewish, in a more positive note, did invest back into its staff all the way through up until the present day. Here we've got a wee staff night out to the Wheel Inn. We've also got annual staff dances that took place. Jewish, being a very old company, were one of the first in the area to really set this up. So it was about trying to make your workforce happy. A happy workforce is a more productive workforce, etc. This is why they invested some money into these activities. But they also got involved in sport as well. Here's the men's football team. And here's the women's football team in 1923. So a very early women's football team. So we move on to pullers, who were perhaps even more into their paternalism. Pullers themselves obviously established the factory on Mill Street. And, Sir Robert Puller himself was heavily involved in local politics. This is the first time that we really see a major company reinvesting back into the local community. This is kind of symbolised by the establishment of, for example, Dunkeld Baths there, which opened in 1887. That photograph is taken by Magnus Jackson. Funnily enough, Magnus Jackson was also an early investor into Dunkeld Baths. But there were also, the whole Pullis family were invested in philanthropic ventures throughout Perth. This is particularly true of Sir Robert Puller, who was known as Perth's Prince, or the Old Man of Perth. He was also, like Sir John Doer, a Liberal MP. He was a politician, and he was a champion for temperance and healthy living, hence the creation of these baths. He also developed other charitable facilities within Perth, including the Soup Kitchen and the Old Men's Society and the Association for Improving the Condition of the Poor. So this idea of paternalism, it sounds quite sweet at the moment, but obviously by having a happy workforce, you're not going to have industrial or trade disputes. And this worked quite well for Pullers up until about 1907, when they had quite a large protest. And we'll talk about that as well. The company also built, like weavers, like the kind of cotton mills across Scotland, they built workers' cottages, including in Tulloch. These were initially built, not these ones, but we had workers' cottages built in 1882 by Honeyman and Kepi, who were obviously the architects within Glasgow, the famous architects. And they also had their workers' institute as well, which came off the back of Tulloch School, which is here photographed in 1900. Quite early on, they took their workers out for outings as well. So here we have here a wee trip to the Isle of Man in the 1950s, would you believe? They look quite young there. So they would finance these trips. They would take people down on trains out for days out, weekends away. They also established groups and societies within organisations as well. Again, this idea of keeping the workforce happy. And that is the Sewing Club in the 1940s. But as I was saying, they didn't have a completely clean break. The workers weren't always happy. And in 1907, led by women of the ironing department, their request for fair pay on a national level was generally ignored. And this is where we have the connection between an industrial protest and again linking back into the rights for votes and to extend the franchise. So some of the women involved in that protest were actually members of the National Federation of the Women Workers, whose general secretary was Mary McArthur, a suffragist. And that brings us on to our final chapter, which is called Mad Acts of the Wild Women. So we've talked about, obviously, the development of the guilds and the incorporations and the rights for men with property to vote. Obviously, this culminated, we've skipped quite a large chapter there in terms of the mid-19th century, in terms of the factory acts and the gradual transition to a completely franchised workforce. But I really want to focus on the suffragette story, mainly because from the people that I've been talking to in Perth, this suffragette story is relatively unknown, unless, of course, you've been to some of the talks over the past few years. So the movement gathers steam in Perth from the mid 19th century onwards, where the Organisation for Women's Suffrage is formed within Perth Town Council. A small group is formed and they request that bills are brought before Parliament, local Parliament, demanding the rights for fair voting, equal voting. We have a few groups being formed up on a local level. We've got Perth, Bridge of Erin and the Scone Suffrage Society and Women's Freedom League being formed. You can see here, right early on in the press, through the People's Journal, Perthshire, that obviously the suffragettes were not treated particularly well, and they were obviously dismissed, this condescending tone that the reformists had with their various charters and referenda proposals early on in the 19th century. So again, this condescending tone from the elite was pressed upon the suffragette movement within Perth. Like many others, they started off peaceful. They went through the petition route. But the suffragists obviously evolved into a separate organisation, the suffragettes, which became more militant in nature. And this resulted in their first major act within Perth, which was the burning down of the Perth Cricket Club Pavilion. This essentially happened because, yet again, the conciliation bill was pushed back from government. And the conciliation bill essentially tried to establish routes in for votes for women through a petitioned manner. But obviously, they were knocked back from Parliament. As a result, we have this major attack on the Cricket Club Pavilion on the 28th of April 1913, where it was completely burnt down. Obviously, at that point, they're still known as the suffragists, suffragist riot in Perth. People from outside Perth were involved, potentially. This is the first time that we see suffragette activity becoming networked within Perth, attracting a lot of people from Dundee and Aberdeen and Glasgow. But as you can see from the photographs there, it's completely destroyed, isn't it? So why does this survive? This arrived in our collection a couple of years ago. It's the Perth Club Pavilion, sorry, Perth Club Cricket Club flag. As you would expect in pavilions, you would keep your flags up there. You wouldn't take them down. They were on show the entire time. So obviously somebody had a bit of inside knowledge potentially about the fire due to take place, or it had already been taken away for some other kind of treatment. We don't know. What I can say is that the suffragettes that were involved in the Cricket Club Pavilion had connections with people, obviously, as members of the Cricket Club. They had connections with the establishment. It's quite possible they gave them a heads up that this activity was going to take place. So this flag arrives at the museum and we have to start to decode its provenance. And we can do that by looking at what's attached to it to start with. We have here that it was presented to the Cricket Club by Mr. and Mrs. D. Gillen, who were responsible for finding the flag in an Edinburgh showroom in 1960. The flag was believed to have been destroyed when the pavilion was burnt down in 1913. So they found the flag. They found the earliest surviving example of the Perth Cricket Club flag, the only one in existence, and it was found in an Edinburgh showroom. The second major act of the suffragettes was what was known as the Bonfires of the West, and this was a coordinated attack on the 3rd of February, the evening of the 3rd of February 1914. We have attacks on three houses happening at the same time. This is, you know, obviously a highly organised activity requiring a high level of coordination. It's worth bearing in mind at this point that out of all of the attacks that the suffragettes did in Scotland, nobody was killed. So obviously there was obviously a concern for people. It wasn't about killing people. It was about inflicting symbolic damage to property and obviously the machinations in terms of damage to the landed gentry and the representation of the elite. So these three buildings were attacked. One is the House of Ross near Cymru. The other is Altnafoon House near St. Fillan's, and Abercool Castle near Cymru as well. So was this an attack on the establishment? Well, possibly. Altnafoon, the proprietor was a Miss Sterling Boyd, who was the secretary of the Children's Holiday Fund. But more importantly, she was a chairperson of the Anti-Suffrage League. So obviously in direct opposition to the suffragettes. The third property was owned by the great-grandson of one of the merchant princes of Manchester. So, you know, this is an attack on the merchant class. The third property, the daughter of this property, was already a non-militant suffragette. Now, when you go into Perth and Kinross archives, we've got this amazing collection of papers from the West Perthshire Liberal Association. And within those papers, you've got a series of somewhat strange letters from the chair of the association at that point to suffragettes. And we've got this letter that relates back to the fires that took place that evening. It says, "Suffragettes, dear creatures, notice your ships Marconied while burning Abercool, and I send your history of Creith herewith." So what does this mean? Well, Marconied could relate to a signal or a message which was used to coordinate attacks. It couldn't have been a portable radio because they weren't really invented at that point. And police stated that no cars were in the area. If you were lucky, you might have got your hands on this type of radio, which was an evolved version of the Marconi radio. But it was highly precious. It was quite rare and unique. It was really only used by armies and the Navy. And obviously, it was really subsequently developed during the First World War. So we're not entirely sure how these attacks were coordinated, but it's quite possible that they were using radios or some other kind of signalling system. The police noting that they couldn't see any unusual activity within the area. So who got busted for this? Well, this is Rhoda Robinson. This is our extract from Perth Prison's records, again, held at our archives. That's Rhoda there. That's her wearing her almost like a semi-military uniform. To me, she's quite an inspirational character. She's been incarcerated, she's in the prison. She looks very strong. She's sitting quite relaxed, quite still. It's interesting to note that when they were recording her details, her complexion was noted as being fresh. But essentially, she was one of the leading suffragettes within the area, and she was incarcerated for that. So who was she? Well, she wasn't local to Perth. She was actually from Kent. She married somebody who worked in the shipyards in Glasgow, a stevedore, who then had a house within Yoker. But she travelled frequently quite up to Perth to take part in demonstrations. She'd been busted a number of times in Glasgow, most notably when she attacked the motorcade of Sir Thomas Mason, who was chairman of the Clyde Trust, basically potentially her husband's boss. And Annie played not guilty, although she admitted later on that she smashed the window, and then she got put in prison for 7 days, after which she continued her suffragette activity. So how did she get busted? Well, the story goes that after the fires, the bonfires of the West, she boarded a train within Perth. She then went down to Glasgow, but what she didn't know was that there were two police officers, two spies sitting behind her in the carriage. She then gets to Glasgow, and if you know Glasgow railway stations, she changes at Central Station, Queen Street Station at that point, and then she makes her way down to Central Station. And at that point, they bust her because they're not sure if she's going to go to London. They're not sure where she's going to go. They were kind of hoping, I think, that she was going to meet up with other network members. So by following her, not arresting her straight away, she was obviously going to reveal the network. Obviously, suffragettes at that point were a highly secretive organisation. But Perth became famous for suffragette activity, not only because of the protests that were happening here and the political ferment that was arising from that deep history. It also became famous because of this guy here, Dr. Hugh Ferguson Watson, who was the surgeon within Perth Prison, appointed in 1914. He's not a very nice guy. He was basically the pioneer of force feeding in Scotland. This is not a story that we're told at schools, but essentially he pioneered the techniques for force feeding, this is really articulated by the story of one individual, Frances Gordon, who wrote a series of letters to the press explaining her treatment and how bad it was. Frances Parker was another suffragette to be imprisoned and force-fed within within the prison. She was connected to the establishment. So unlike Rhoda, who was connected to her husband, she was working, she lived in Glasgow as part of a working class family. Fanny Parker was directly attached to the establishment through her uncle, who was Lord Kitchener. She was incarcerated at Perth Prison because of an attack on Lloyd George, who was scheduled to speak in Aberdeen and in Dundee, and she was also incarcerated because of her ongoing activities and obviously her status as the leader of the Women's Freedom League. She was also one of the first suffragettes to be incarcerated and held under what was known as the Cat and Mouse Act. Now, do we all know what the Cat and Mouse Act was? Yeah, we all do. So most of us do. Cat and Mouse Act essentially was absolutely brutal. It basically entailed that if you were arrested as a suffragette and force-fed, they would then release you, only for you to then be brought back in, potentially as well. So they would try and attempt to force-feed you, they would release you, they would bring back in. So that way you would have an ongoing incarceration, you'd be dismissed, you'd be discharged from prison, and then brought back in with, according to the same, charge that you've been brought in the first place. So you could be rearrested for the same charge and then force-fed. Absolutely disgusting. The treatment of suffragettes within Perth Prison began to get picked up by the local press, where we have headlines such as the inhuman treatment of an unconvicted prisoner in Perth, unconvicted, including rectum feeding, which is absolutely horrible. I should say here that you've got this highlight here, which talks about the suffragette being kept on her back and prevented from moving another hour. That kind of like contradicts the iconography of force feeding, which usually shows, women sitting on a chair and being force-fed. That wasn't the case at all. They were usually strapped down on their back. Now, Arabella Charlotte Scott is another famous suffragette that was imprisoned within Perth, mainly because she was on hunger strike for about four times because of her attempts, after being arrested, because of her attempts to burn down Kelso Racecourse. She'd also been in the prison, again, in Holloway Prison, for about 21 days, and then tried, because she also attempted to petition the Prime Minister. She was also incarcerated under the Cat and Mouse Act. But the most inspirational element of Arabella's story is the fact that there was a vigil held outside the prison, and it's noted in the press that up to 3,000 people stayed outside with candlelight and calling for her release. Arabella was then released in July 1914. So we've got a series of quite non-violent acts taking place. The final one that I want to talk about really is St. Ninian's Cathedral. St. Ninian's Cathedral is quite significant because we have this service that's taking place on the 20th of July 1914. We've got this reference within the parish records of a certain Norrie Miller of general accident fame being needlessly rough with a suffragette. So they, at the end of a hymn, they stood at the front, they had a little bit of a protest, and then they got bungled out. But the minister, writing in the records, says that, "I'm afraid that Norrie Miller was needlessly rough. They are the most exasperating vixens ever breathed, but so outrageously so that it is a pity that he descended to their level." Unreal. The treatment of the media, treatment by the media of the suffragettes continued to be pretty bad. So on the one hand, we've got articles about force feeding in Perth Prison. We've got articles of peaceful protests and church sermons. And on the other hand, we've got this depiction of, this condescending depiction of suffragettes yet again as being just silly women that are just trying to play it, trying to get equal rights. But the final chapter of this story is really, again, another petition. And this is the key thing about Perth and petitions, is that on the afternoon of the 10th of July 1914, King George V, obviously this is before the outbreak of the First World War, was visiting Perth. He was coming to open up the Perth Royal Infirmary, a new ward within Perth Royal Infirmary. And as the motorcade moved through the town, Rhoda Fleming, different Rhoda, because he did change names, dashed from the crowd and attempted to approach the royal car. She then throws on petition that we've got downstairs, and she jumps in front of the car, basically, and gets that close to George V. You've got to realise that this is just 1 month after the assassination of Franz Ferdinand. You know, this is quite substantial, because you would think that security would have been quite tight at that point. She could have been assassinated, she could have been killed for her actions, an incredibly courageous act. In fact, one of the newspapers at that time explained it as being perhaps the most daring act in the history of the women's suffrage movement. Sorry. We've also got this banner, a complete unique survivor within the museum collection. It's dated, again, same year, 1914. I don't think we know who the embroiderers are, but it's absolutely stunning. It's got a high level of detail, and it's in fantastic condition. And obviously, it's survived all the way through to the present day. As you know, we're opening up next year with the Stone of Destiny at a brand new Perth Museum. But did you know that the Stone of Destiny was also attacked by the suffragettes? This occurred on... in June 1914, and a suffragette, at that point you could get access to the Stone of Destiny quite easily. There was no security around it. The coronation chair was open access as well, obviously above the Stone of Destiny. A woman dressed in a disguise with a large dress and a feather boa snuck in an improvised explosive. I have to say it was incredibly, you know, clever explosive, because it didn't destroy the entire chair. It was a symbolic act. But obviously the suffragettes at that point had access to bomb-making material, and that potentially links them back in with the military and the establishment once again as well. So Scott was actually, coming back to Scott, she was released just 2 days before the Archduke Franz Ferdinand was assassinated and the First World War began. The WSPU then announced a truce on militant acts, and then with the outbreak of the World War, that's it. The cause for the movement has been extinguished. This results in all suffragettes being released from the prison in August 1914. So all of these stories are to be displayed within the new, brand new Perth Museum, within what a display called as the Common Good. That gives you an idea of the elevation of the display. There's a suffragette banner and other items as well. But really, I just wanted to kind of like wrap up by saying that the suffragette story was the culmination of this movement that starts very early on in Perth in the medieval, post-medieval period, for men and workers trying to gain voices within local parliamentary democracies, and then culminates with the suffragette movement and the outbreak of the First World War. It is important to note, obviously, that suffrage continued well beyond the First World War. A common misconception is that they all got the vote in 1918. Wasn't the case. It was another 10 years in 1928 when true suffrage was realised. So that's us. Thank you for your time.